Hey guys, and welcome to Swami Studios. I am your host, MoonlightSwami, and today I'm bringing you guys another installment of the My Player series. I know, it's it's really something. I love this series a lot. And, well, today I'm going to be talking about, he's a bit of an exception to the rule that I made that it was going to only be people who were, played the majority of their careers in the 1950s and earlier, but he deserves the recognition. There's always an exception to the rule, at least one, and he's the person. His name, Curtis Flood. If you don't know him, sit back, relax, and enjoy, and if you do, hope you learn something. You're out. Flood was born January 18th, 1938. Moved to Oakland, where he was born, he was not born there, but he was raised there. He was a 7-time Gold Glover, 3-time All-Star, 2-time World Series champion with the St. Louis Cardinals. He has the 3rd most games in center field behind Richie Ashburn and Willie Mays with 1,863 games. He started out his professional career in 1956, signed with the Cincinnati Redlegs. And if you don't know the background behind why they were named that, because of McCarthyism, they changed their name from the Reds, because red meant communism, so they changed their name to the Redlegs. They got rid of the word Reds in their logo, and they stuck to the wishbone C, which is now the logo of the Chicago Bears. So, and it's also the logo of the Reds. But in December of 1957, he was traded to the St. Louis Cardinals, and that's where he began his career. He's the first player to get a hit in a regular season game in Canada in the Expos' first home game in 1950, it was somewhere around there. He got it, okay? Yeah, it was 1969. In that same year, Flood had some personal problems on and off the field. His brother was arrested mid-season I'm not going to go into that, it's not really important. And he had conflicts with the Cardinals, wanting a $100,000 salary, which would translate to about maybe $600,000 salary now. But Curt Flood is best known for his role in the creation of free agency and eliminating the reserve clause, which was basically what they used prior. It kept players tied to their original teams for life unless traded or released. So there was no free agency, there was no signing with other teams like now. Albert Pujols would still be on the Cardinals, all that stuff. This came about on October 7th, 1969, after being traded to the Philadelphia Phillies in a 6-man trade. Dick Allen was supposed to go over to the Cardinals, and he really didn't like it. This was before the trade deadline, of course, because it was in late October. But he really did not like the trade. He thought the Phillies sucked, pretty much, that's summation. He hated the Connie Mack Stadium. He thought the fans were raucous and racist, and he did not want to be a part of the organization. So he did not show up to the Phillies, and then he later sent a letter to then-commissioner Bowie Kuhn, who was commissioner from February of 69. He was there for less than a year at this point. He sent a letter demanding to have the commish declare him a free agent. The request was denied after citing the reserve clause in his 1969 contract, and therein lies the true beginning of what really changed baseball. In January of 1970, only a few months later, Curtis Flood filed a lawsuit against MLB alleging violations of antitrust laws. He then compared it to slavery. Former players such as Jackie Robinson and Hank Greenberg testified on his behalf, along with the former owner, Billy Veeck. But no active players testified or really talked to Flood during this time period. They were pretty much against him possibly ruining their careers, and they were very afraid that if they were involved, they would be shunned from baseball. Flood was very instrumental in all of these things. He was about a 294 lifetime hitter, just putting that out there. Really good player, center fielder. The case ended up going to before the Supreme Court, but the Supreme Court used the old Latin saying, stare decisis, or to stand by things decided. It ruled in favor of the MLB, 5-3, citing as a precedent at a 1922 ruling in the case, Federal Baseball Club versus National League, just saying that baseball did not apply to the Sherman antitrust laws. In 1970, the owners agreed to the 10-5 rule, or some people call it the Curtis Flood rule, which allowed players of 10 years in baseball, the last five with the same team, to veto any trade. That was very good, but it wasn't exactly what he was looking for. So, I'm going to go a little bit further. He then sat out the entire 1970 season and became a drunk and a drug addict through this whole process of widespread hatred towards him and over the lawsuit and making a quote-unquote mockery of baseball. He retired in 1971 after batting .200 with the Washington Senators in only a few games. Even though Ted Williams did want him to stick around, he did not. 4 years later, however, in 1975, arbitrator Peter Seitz ruled that since Andy Messersmith and Dave McNally played for one season without a contract, they were entitled to become free agents, thus nullifying the reserve clause and opened the door to widespread free agency. These are my words. These are not, you know, copywritten. Just saying. This is how I talk. I don't know why. It just seemed a little fake when I was speaking, and I don't know why, but whatever. But yeah, that opened the door to a lot of people becoming free agents, which was really something. Really changed the game of baseball. Helped get guys real contracts, all that stuff. He stopped smoking in 1979 and drinking in 86. But he was diagnosed with throat cancer in 1995. He had a really high chance of surviving it. He did beat it, but he was rendered mute or unable to talk for the remainder of his life. He died 2 years later on January 20th, 1997, 2 days after his 59th birthday, after developing pneumonia. Curtis Flood is one of the lesser-known players who changed baseball and was one of the most instrumental parts in baseball history. I honestly think that without Curtis Flood, baseball would still be... It would actually be pretty different. It wouldn't necessarily be a place where people could have careers and only play baseball, which would have been odd because that I believe it opened the door to football having free agency as well. I'm not positive, though. But could you imagine if there was no free agency and athletes had to have normal jobs? That would really bring them down to earth and that would really be something. But regardless, it's interesting just thinking back of how much of an impact Curt Flood had on MLB and everybody as a whole, pretty much. I mean, maybe players would stick with their entire team their entire career. That would be interesting. I mean, if you think about it, the Expos would have had Randy Johnson, Pedro Martinez, Vlad Guerrero, everybody for life. Could you imagine the powerhouse that would have been? It would have been like the Yankees. And there is why. Ta-da! That's why the Yankees have so many championships. Because they had the same core of players who never left, never was offered any other money, never had a chance to leave. They were there for life. And that's really something. If you think about it, yes, they had great talent. They acquired great talent through just signing them and whatever. But if they ever considered trading them, that was the only way of getting rid of them. Their contracts didn't expire. They had to deal with the bad and they had to deal with the good. All the other teams had to deal with the bad. So I think that's very interesting. That could have definitely explained for a lot of Yankee World Championships, probably the Murderer Row Yankees. Pretty much it would explain it. But, guys, this video is pretty much over, so I'm going to give you a little bit of... Just wanted to tell you something. I'm sorry I didn't upload yesterday. I just was not feeling it. I played this for about 3 hours. I loved playing this so much. You're going to see a little bit of a repeat in the gameplay tomorrow during the podcast. And I'm going to probably reuse some of the Gibson My Player footage just for some more talking videos like this. I might have to stop the Nationals franchise and restart it when the season starts because there is no Bryce Harper. He is not in the game. Neither is Yoenis Cespedes. And that really sucks. I mean, such a great player. I can't call him up, so I might have to wait till he's actually on the team or in the game or something. Or I'll just create him, and then that'll be that. But, so here's what's going to happen tomorrow. Tomorrow, I'm going to have the first episode of the Gibson My Player on Machinima Sports. So if you would, go over there, drop a rating, leave a nice comment, give me some support on Machinima Sports. That'll be fantastic, because I actually get paid for those videos, and it's a good way of building me up some exposure here. And then, later in the day, the beginning of the podcast will be going up on GameFace Studios, which I'm going to have the full part here, but I do want you to watch that video, support them, really great channel. I'm going to have the full video here, and that's going to be that. So, I'm going to be putting up the podcast tomorrow. It's 50 minutes long. You don't need to watch it. Just need to listen. If you love baseball and if you love the discussion about steroids or really want to know my opinions towards it, then by all means, it will be 50 minutes with regular Dave 2975. Great, great podcast. We'll have another one coming up this Wednesday, most likely, of us talking about football, free agency, the bounty system, all of that stuff. So guys, I just wanted to say thank you so much for all of your support. I'll try to do the fantasy things. If any of you guys really have a fantasy draft in the next few days, please let me know. I'll just send you the list of people who I have. Otherwise, you know, that's that. Guys, I'm on the Rockies, and I pull my average up to about 242 from 212 at this point. Really good, really, really good play for Josh Gibson. Really working hard as a catcher, trying to give the Rockies a late playoff push, down eight games under 500 when he first got called up. Now only 4 games back. I hope you enjoyed, guys. Stay tuned tomorrow for some amazing gameplay on 3 different channels, Machinima Sports, GameFace Studios, and here. I'm MoonlightSwami, and I'll be talking to you guys later. Peace, I'm out.